Marking the 3 million Kentucky and Indiana residents who have received at least their first vaccination dose doesn't tell the full story. In both states, the majority of those getting the vaccines are white, 87% in Indiana and approximately 74% in Kentucky. Just 5% of the vaccinated in Indiana have been black. In Kentucky, just over 4% have been black. The coronavirus pandemic has exposed many inequities in our healthcare system. Black Americans are at a much higher risk of contracting COVID and dying from the virus. Many of these issues can be traced back to systemic racism. Dennis Ting is digging deeper into how real estate and redlining led to these gaps in our healthcare in Louisville.
Open a map of Louisville. Find Hikes Point, then find Parkland. The two separated by just 10 miles, but for two boys growing up in those neighborhoods in the 60s and 70s, their experiences were much further apart.
I have the opportunities that I have today because my parents had the opportunities that they had.
It's been pretty desolate for quite a few years. That makes it just difficult on everything.
To see the difference, you have to look at color and the lines on a map. Let's look at another map. Louisville, March 12, 1938. This was what was called a residential security map. The Homeowners Loan Corporation was created under President Franklin D. Roosevelt's New Deal to let people borrow money to own homes, and real estate agents helped color code the different neighborhoods in Louisville. Green means go, invest, red means stop, it's too risky. But the main factor in the color assigned to the map was the color of the people living in those communities.
The government recognized that homeownership was a good thing, but the government also was filled with people who were white supremacists.
Remember this boy? This is John Borders, a real estate attorney who has studied what has been called redlining.
They created opportunities for white citizens and they neglected opportunities for black citizens.
Maps like these drove investment into these yellow, blue, and green areas where mostly white residents lived, taking away resources and opportunities from the red areas where mostly black residents lived.
We get back to no businesses are there, there's no grocery stores there.
Redlining also made it extremely hard for black Americans to receive loans, money which would go instead to people like John's parents.
There's no question that I benefited directly from those discriminatory practices.
John now works to fix the effects of redlining, which are still seen today. West Louisville, still a collection of predominantly black neighborhoods, is still fighting to attract business, access to fresh and affordable food, and health care.
I do remember growing up, any issues, any problems you had, everybody had to go downtown to the general hospital.
Remember this boy? This is Dr. Mark V. Burns, an infectious disease specialist with U of L Health with more than 30 years of practicing medicine. His journey spurred by seeing a lack of healthcare opportunities growing up.
Way back in the 70s, when they founded like the Park Duval Center, to be located, you know, predominantly in the West End, that was a godsend for so many, many families.
This Park Duval Health Center helped start EMS. They had the first ambulance service.
This is Ann Hagen Grigsby. She started working at Park Duval Community Health Center in 1992 and has worked her way up to CEO. Growing up in Washington, D.C., she knows healthcare inequity is not a problem unique to Louisville.
I grew up, you know, with a foster child, then I got adopted, and I saw my adopted mother die before she was 65 because she didn't have access to health care.
While her center and other federally qualified health centers are a step in the right direction in providing care for underserved communities, more still needs to be done, especially when it comes to battling the coronavirus pandemic. Ann says she is in serious need of more vaccines.
100 doses a week is not going to meet the need. It would take 30 weeks to do 3,000 people?
Both Ann and Mark say another hurdle they're facing is reaching out to people who may still be hesitant or confused about the vaccine. Mark says direct outreach is key in overcoming these barriers.
I'm ready, willing, and able to go door to door, person by person, throughout the West End.
But beyond the coronavirus pandemic, there are still other issues when it comes to tackling the effects of redlining on healthcare. It's not enough just to build more clinics.
If we eliminate the issues of poverty, systemic racism, all of this goes away.
Better health means access to fresh food, to better paying jobs, to affordable housing, to the opportunities redlined away many decades earlier.
We could make a better choice if we had a choice to make.
With producer Taylor Weider, Dennis Ting, WHAS 11 News.